All right, can you hear me now? Check 1, 2.
Can you hear me now? He owes Verizon some money.
Uh-oh. What does that mean?
That's their phrase.
What's what?
That's their phrase. Can you hear me now?
Oh, got it. Is it all trademarked?
Yeah, I'm sure.
All right, good morning. So before we get started, just have a couple of quick announcements. Hope you guys can hear me. All right, can you guys hear me?
Yep.
All right, cool. So just a couple things. Hammond Hi-Fi has a clearance thing going on this morning. So after the meeting, definitely go down there. It has a bunch of free stuff, $2 stuff, $5 stuff, free stuff. I haven't mentioned that. Yeah, bring your wallet. He's trying to get a little bit of a lot of different things there. Hopefully that's better. There we go. We'll talk about field day stuff after we chat with the guys with Ham Radio Now. Just a real quick call out to Betsy, K1EIR, is it? So they traveled way far. Betsy, right? Correct? Yes, she was the section manager of Connecticut. When did you retire from that?
Last year, after 25 years.
Wow. Congratulations. I think my microphone's dying again. Great to see you here. So we're going to go get started. We have a presentation where at least we got the gang from Ham Radio Now. If you guys haven't seen them, they're on YouTube. They talk about different things related to amateur radio. You usually see them at some of the conventions and other places here in FAR. So we'll go ahead and start off with them, and then we'll get into some of the other stuff that we have for the club afterwards. So I will go ahead and turn it over to you guys.
Hey, so the question is, can you hear me and see me? Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
All right. Saturday morning, 8 a.m. Really? I mean, you know, fortunately for me, that's Pacific time, and I'm on East Coast, so it's 11 o'clock here. But I'm impressed. And they said that you guys would, you know, it could get 75 to 100 people or so. I'm not sure that there's that many, because we might have scared a bunch of people away. But
there we go.
Okay, now you can hear me. Yeah, so you guys might want to mute your audio coming back to me, at least until we're done. And so it's 11 o'clock here in North Carolina. I'm going to try to look at my camera, so I'm looking at you guys. What I've got here is, you know, the big screen with you guys on it. And there you are. And oh, by the way, we're on Facebook Live, so you're all getting very, very famous. And I've had a technological failure of my own. I've got my co-host, David Goldenberg, W0DHG, and I can't promote him up to full screen for some reason. The Skype is not working right. So, David, you're a tiny little box right now, but we can probably hear you.
All right. Well, good morning, everyone. Glad to join you today.
So you talked, and you became, maybe have I got this thing on dynamic?
Here I am.
Oh, yeah. Okay. That might work. So goodbye, you guys. Here's David.
Good morning.
All right. So your club, I did a little research, just a little research. Your club began with a grudge. Back in 1968, Larry Oakley, who's now W7AB, moved to Reno in the 60s. He joined his local radio club there in Reno, Nevada, and he found it was full of FUDs. And that's a term that I got from Bob Bruninga, WB4APR. He's the first guy I heard refer to the old, you know, stick-in-the-mud hams as FUDs. So he started a new club there in Reno in 1968, and he called it the Sierra Nevada Amateur Radio Society. Do you guys call that SNARS? I would imagine.
Sure, whatever.
So you know how fortunate, and maybe he was thinking about this, so he didn't call it the Sierra Nevada Amateur Radio Club, because then from then on, you guys would be the Snark.
I don't know. I kind of like that.
I'm pretty sure I'm not the first person to bring this up, but maybe. Is Larry there today? He's still around.
He's not here today, no.
Okay. Yeah, that's too bad. So my question now is the club still full of FUDs, or is it back to being full of FUDs? Are you guys FUDs?
No.
Are you guys? No, we're not FUDs. We'll find out. All right. So this is Ham Radio Now, and we are doing this live on Facebook. So you're getting famous, and we're recording it. We'll make an episode out of this because I need fodder. So this is episode 332. I'd written down 331 here, but no, this is episode 332. Yep. I've screwed up my picture already. So there's David back again. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. This is for the video, David.
And I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
And Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. So behind me is our mascot, ARVN. I'll explain where the ARVN name came from. He's the chief financial officer of Ham Radio Now. And if anybody out there in the club or out there in television land is interested in helping us fund things, costs a lot of money to do this, hamradionow.tv is the place to go. So there's my ARVN, and David's got the West Coast version of ARVN in there. All right, so I wanted to give you a little bit of a background because, you know, I'm a famous television personality now. So how did I get that way? I was first licensed in 1965. So yeah, I've been a ham for 52 years. Originally as a novice, WN9NSO, age 15 in the Chicago suburbs. Got my general a few months later, became WA9NSO. A few years later, an advanced, and then I finally made it to extra in the year 2000. I have had a career mostly in television since 1973. As a video editor, I have mostly made commercials, training programs, a few real broadcast TV programs. I've done a little bit of wannabe radio disc jockeying, just a little bit. And my video career had a short stint at NBC, the real NBC, the network, at their Chicago station, WMAQ. And the only thing that I did there that you would have ever heard of is that for a couple of years, I edited segments for Phil Donahue. You've heard of him. For the Today Show. And no, I only met Phil once in person, very briefly. He had no idea who he was. I worked with his producer all the time. And across that time, this was in the 70s, late 70s, I was also very active in amateur radio. Became the president of the Chicago FM Club, a big radio club in Chicago. Personally, he had a strong focus on VHF and FM. Really loved FM once it started to become a thing. And my notes are now out of order. This is the nightmare scenario. So let me try to find what my next. No, that must have been it, or maybe it didn't. It didn't. Maybe a page. Oh, there we go. See, and most people, if they did something like that, they would edit this part out, but I won't. It's too much work. So I had a focus on VHF FM repeaters. I became the president of the radio club, did their newsletter. All of this was in my mid to late 20s. And it turns out that it was overwhelming. The responsibility of doing that, running a ham fest. I, in 1979, early 1980, ran screaming from ham radio. So after having been very active for about 15 years, I got out. I was inactive in amateur radio for most of the 1980s. I moved to North Carolina in 1990 and spent a little time in Arizona in between, left Chicago in 86, tried that disc jockey thing in Arizona for a little while. It sort of worked out. And then moved to North Carolina in 1990. It was a family deal. My dad had retired down here. I got back into ham radio to meet people because I was on my own. didn't know anybody, so met guys in the local radio club and got going with radio. The call sign KN4AQ, the call sign I've got now, was actually born in Knoxville. So between Arizona and North Carolina, Raleigh, North Carolina, I had a short stint in Knoxville, Tennessee. And I repeated my history from Chicago. I became the newsletter editor, the club president, but I learned to set limits, sort of. So I haven't run screaming yet. And David, my notes say it's time for your bio.
All right. So I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG. I live in Los Angeles, California with my family. I became a ham at age 43 in 2011 because I did a CERT program and I thought there was a little bit more that I could do. I became, at that time I was KJ6MCQ. I became W0DHG and a general class operator in 2012. I joined Aries in between. I was an AEC. Currently I'm a EC and also the net manager for Aries LAX. I do a lot of community service here. I've done 5 Baker to Vegas races and 3 AC100 races. Boy Scout leader for about 5 years. My son is an Eagle Scout. My daughter is working on her Silver Award. And I joined Ham Radio Now in 2016. My career has been an IT professional. I've been doing that for about 25 years.
Oh.
And mostly I do this show because I want to meet guys like you, or groups like you.
Yeah, so that means you must be done. Which, they're laughing at you, David. I mean, they're laughing with you, David.
That's great.
All right. So Ham Radio Now. Yeah, in a minute. So I've always had, I'm going to make you go away for a second, David. I've always had a latent interest in journalism. Latent. I've never really been a journalist. I was the PIO and the newsletter editor for the Chicago Club. Well, the newsletter editor for the Chicago Club, the PIO, public information officer, newsletter editor for the club here in Raleigh, the Raleigh Amateur Radio Society. That led to editing a regional magazine called the Repeater Journal. It's published by the Southeastern Repeater Association. That's our frequency coordination group for the Southeast. I've done some writing for CQ and CQVHF and for QST, but I've always been a TV guy. As an editor, I didn't get my hands on cameras very much. I didn't go out in the field, but when they were available, I picked up some of the first VHS cameras and then 8mm and high 8 cameras, the video, not the film stuff. So that was in the 80s and 90s mostly. I taught myself how to shoot with cameras like that. I only edited a little bit of the stuff that I shot, just a little bit. In 1999, however, I shot, produced, and edited my first real ham radio video, and it's called The Introduction to Amateur Radio. And people have attempted to do an introduction to amateur radio of one kind or another out there in ham radio media, either in print or lately on video, and it is hard to do. It's like pointing a fire hose at people. You have a lot of information to put out, and I was aware of that. I knew that was a potential problem. So when I did this introduction to amateur radio, I kept it fairly well condensed. The whole idea of doing this program, because this is before YouTube, before the internet, it was 1999. I needed an introduction to a class. My friend Jeff, AC4ZO, and I, Jeff has been a co-host on Ham Radio Now. We needed something to introduce the concept of amateur radio to a class. We had usually brought in equipment, radios and stuff, and showed them, but we couldn't really operate them in the classroom we were in. We couldn't get antennas out and stuff. So we actually went out and shot repeaters and mobile operation and HF operation in a shack and made about a 35-minute program out of it. It is now available on YouTube. So if you go out there and search Introduction to Amateur Radio, you better add the year 1999 and maybe my call sign, KN4AQ, to it, and you can find it. It's been very popular. I think it's up in the 30,000 view range. And even though it's way out of date, Well, you know, ham radio is not moving along all that fast, so a few things are out of date. Let's fast forward. We're only going to fast forward a little bit to 2003. In 2003, the space shuttle Columbia broke up on reentry and scattered pieces all over East Texas, rural East Texas. Federal agencies, state agencies, they all converged. The idea was to recover and analyze as much of the debris as they could get. They discovered in rural East Texas in 2003 that they couldn't talk to each other. Their radios didn't, some of their radios didn't work at all because they didn't have any repeater coverage or radio coverage out there. So all they had was simplex, and they had a really wide area to cover. But even the state agencies didn't have good communications coverage out there, and nobody could talk to anyone else because the concept of interoperability didn't exist at that point. Ham radio saved the day. The hams in Nacogdoches, Texas, with the repeaters that they had on the air, a couple of repeaters covering most of the territory that needed to be covered, became the saviors for communication. And so the hams went out there and they provided communications for everybody. Now everybody could talk to everybody through the ham repeaters. So I thought, what a great opportunity for some ham publicity and some video. So I still only had the Hi-8 cameras, but I thought, well, it'd be great to go out there. I had gone freelance. I worked for a company for about 10 years here, 1990 to about 2000, 2001. And then I quit and went freelance and thought I would have time. And my phone started ringing and I got swamped with freelance work and I couldn't go. Turns out that wasn't such a problem because, I wouldn't have been allowed to shoot any video there anyway. They had a real tight lid on all this stuff. But what I was thinking of at that time was hams had done very little video. There was very little ham radio video out there in any form. Again, still a little bit pre-internet. There wasn't really all that much still photography. Hams had just been really bad at documenting what we do in emergency communications and public service communications. We didn't do very much of it. We did a lot of that communication, but we didn't document it. QSD had a hard time getting pictures. Everybody had a hard time getting pictures. So I thought it would be great to go out there and do that. Turns out I wouldn't have been able to had I had the time, but I was thinking about it. I did interview the guys that performed all of this ham radio activity on the phone, and I wrote an article for CQ about it. So the seed was planted. And David, I'm going to invite you to jump in anytime you want.
Sure.
I know you've seen my rundown here, and there's not a lot for you in it, but anything you want to jump in. This is pre-ham radio for you.
Yeah, absolutely.
By several years.
Absolutely. Although I do remember where I was seeing in Los Angeles when the space shuttle broke up, we could actually see here separation. So I knew something was going on that particular day. And
so you were watching it go over. You were watching it go overhead.
Yeah, I was in Santa Monica, California. We saw it go over.
Yeah.
And you could tell there was a problem then.
Had you even heard of amateur radio at that point?
You know, I had heard and was interested about it in the probably early 90s. But there was still the code requirement and, you know, life and work and all the other things got in the way. And just never really picked it up at that time.
All right. So the video seed was planted at that point. And what I did was create a company or a video production company called ARVN, Amateur Radio Video News. About that time, in the late 90s to early 2000s, I didn't want to do a program using Hi-8. You know, that I had recorded some stuff in Hi-8. The 1999 introduction was Hi-8. Hi-8 looked okay, but I was used to broadcast television. I was used to what real TV looked like. Real TV being things with cameras that cost $90,000 and production studios that cost $250,000. And, you know, none of that was going to happen on a ham radio shoestring budget. But starting in the late 90s and early 2000s, a video format called DV was developed, digital video. The quality of the cameras in the recording took a exponential leap from the predecessor, Hi8 Video. It was digital. It was it looked pretty much as good as the broadcast television that I've been working with. And I'm going to let you go, David, so you can sniffle and
sorry, and
do whatever you want to do. It was very impressive, but the most important thing about it was affordable. Now, that's if you consider a $4,500 camera affordable. $4,500 is expensive, but compared to a typical $80,000 or $90,000 broadcast television camera, it was just about as good. And for me, anyway, I would consider that affordable. And then I learned about an event, the W3AO 51A field day operation. Now, you guys, how many of you guys that ever from where you guys are ever heard of W3AO and their 51A field day? A little bit.
Couple hands there.
Yeah. If you worked them during field day, did you wonder what the deal was? Like 51A? Come on, you guys got to be kidding.
At first, yeah.
Yeah. So, that's what I thought, and I'd worked them, and I thought, you know, that can't be real. So I called up the guy that was running the show, and I arranged to go up there and do a documentary. I bought that camera and actually borrowed some audio equipment from one of the companies I freelanced at, and I went up there and shot the documentary. And I came up with this terrible name for the video company, ARVN, Amateur Radio Video News. And by the way, that's where Arvin's name comes from, because everybody started calling it Arvin. I didn't call it Arvin, but everybody else called it Arvin. So he's a legacy of this ARVN thing. And one of the ARL CEO at the time, K1ZZ, Dave, said, "You know what Arvin means, don't you?" And I said, "No." He says, "It's the Army of the Republic of Vietnam." So maybe not such a good name. So I went up and shot that documentary as ARVN. Another thing that was happening around that same time, and let's see if you guys remember this, BPL. Anybody heard of BPL? Not Brass Pounders League. Broadband over power line. Does that ring any bells? That was the big scare back then. So there was actually not very many places in the country had this BPL thing. It was the idea was putting broadband on power lines. You know, there's wires, and the broadband was RF, covered the HF spectrum, at least around here. There's one little demonstration area in a small neighborhood that was about 20-minute drive from my house. And I was able to drive down there and document what this was all about. And I sent some of the video up to ARL. So again, a little bit more fame and credibility doing that. My early plan with this ARVN thing was to make a magazine show, you know, maybe 30, 40 minutes long, with a bunch of maybe 10-minute stories in it, release it on DVD, and send it out as club meeting programs for just exactly what you're doing now. A couple times a year, maybe once a quarter, you guys would sit there and watch this news broadcast on DVD. I never did that. I did shoot and release my first DVD. It was a talk on standing wave ratios, a really good talk on SWR, still an excellent talk. It's I put it on YouTube so you can go watch that if you want to. And I'll put a link at the end of the show to some of these videos that I'm talking about. And then I shot another documentary. SWR talk is called Standing Up for Standing Waves, if you want to look it up. And then I made this as the next program that I produced. It's a documentary. Where's the camera I want? There we go. On direction finding, ARDF. Just happened to be coming up the road from me in a park that was just a mile or so from my house, but it was the U.S. Championships. And so since it was going to be convenient and wasn't going to cost me anything to go cover, took the camera out and and recorded it and made this documentary DVD and released that. So what did I do next? I went up to Dayton, did a bunch of stuff up at Dayton. Let's see, I've got a couple more DVDs. In 2007, I did my first tour of the Dayton Hamvention. You know, I don't know. I made it once again as the length for a ham radio club meeting and thought maybe people, you know, especially out your way where hams don't get to Dayton all the time, they'd like to see what was going on. Both of those DVDs, they sold. I was kind of hoping that they would sell in the 300 to 500 copy. I think my first run of recordings was a couple of hundred. And they sold a couple of hundred. But they didn't sell anywhere near where what I was hoping for. This is another one of the DVDs that I made from a couple of years worth of Dayton. This is from 2009. Let's see. Yeah, there we go. And at Dayton, I recorded another couple of tours, and I recorded some forums. I recorded some FCC forums and some of the other forums that they did. I was the first person to do that. Now it's very popular to record forums at Dayton, but I was the first one to do that. And then finally, in 2011, I released the video, the very first one that I shot in 2004, and I called it The Last Big Field Day, documentary of W3AO. And they were thinking they would be 51A. Turns out when they did their final count, it was 50A. But that was still pretty good in 2004. So 7 years to get that first production out. But at least I finally got it out. So let's see. Try not to lose all my papers.
You didn't talk about Tapper at all yet.
That's true. Sometime in there, I also went up to the Tapper conference in Chicago, I think 2008 and 2009, the Tapper conference. Tapper is the formerly known as the Tucson Amateur Packet Radio. Now they're, you know, all things digital in ham radio. And I got invited to, document those. So I also made DVDs of those. And, this is before I did anything in terms of the internet. All right, so what about ham radio now? Well, in 2011, I was driving home from the Dayton Hamvention, and this guy named Bob Heil, K9EID, called me on the phone. I knew who he was. I didn't know that he knew who I was. I didn't know him personally. I'd probably seen him at a ham fest or so. And he told me that he was starting this show on this network called Twit, called Ham Nation. Now, how many, raise your hand if you've ever watched Ham Nation. Okay, so not as many of you as I would have expected. Raise your hand if you've ever seen Ham Radio Now. I'm almost as popular as Ham Nation. Awesome. Yeah, I'll take that. Okay, it was going to be on this network called Twit. Okay, on what now? Twit.
There's another great name there, right?
Yeah. Well, you know, and Leo Laporte called it Twit on purpose. This Week in Tech is what it was all about. So Bob was going to start this program on Twit, and he knew he was going to do a lot of traveling. It was going to be a weekly program, and he does conferences throughout the year, so he'd be missing, you know, quite a few shows that he wouldn't be able to be the host for. And he needed somebody who had a little bit of television chops to be able to fill in when he was traveling. He had recruited, at that time, Gordon West, WB6NOA, to be on the show. And that was pretty much it. And none of the rest of the folks that you've seen on Ham Nation had been on the show. So I agreed on the condition that he never asked me to do it every week because I didn't have time. And I loved doing it. And I hated how Bob did it. He was boring. He was dull. He was Mr. Rogers. Hi, boys and girls. We're going to do some ham radio today. And, you know, in that first 6 months or so that I was doing shows, I did about six or seven of them. I might have expressed that opinion about the way he did the shows to maybe just a few too many people. Because at some point, he stopped calling me to do the show. He never told me he was never going to do the show again. He just, I never got another phone call to do the show. And he moved on to having other people on there. But that's where I learned about this thing called podcasting. All right, your turn again. Raise your hand if you know what podcasting is. All right, well, you guys are getting a little more with it, so that's pretty good. Raise your hand if you don't know what podcasting is.
Just a couple.
Okay. Little podcasting tutorial when we're done here. I didn't know what podcasting was. I knew that YouTube had been around. You know, I knew it was, at least from my perspective of it, and I lacked knowledge and vision about all this stuff. I considered the internet to be a really bad medium for television. And I was thinking this real TV, the little postage stamp video on your screen that updated, you know, four or five frames per second at best. And I never saw the internet becoming a medium for especially this high definition television. I didn't think that was going to happen. So I was doing DVDs, and about the same time that I started doing DVDs, 2004, this guy who pretty quickly joined Ham Nation and started doing the smoke and solder thing, George Thomas, W5JDX, started Amateur Logic TV, 2004. Same year I was starting ARVN on DVDs, he started it on the internet. YouTube was getting started back then, too. His production was crude. My production values and the DVDs that I put out were way, way better than what George was doing. But he was on the internet, so come on. All right, so I made my DVDs. I made maybe 10 or 15 programs eventually between the stuff that I've done. In 7 years, you know, one or two programs a year. I guess that's why I told Bob, don't ask me to do the show every day, every week, because no way could I do it. So in 2012, and that's about the time Bob was not calling me anymore for Ham Nation, I decided to change ARVN to an online program. I pivoted, got the name Ham Radio Now, got the website hamradionow.com. I call it hamradionow.tv because it's a TV show, but I didn't want to do anything until I actually got hamradionow.com, and that somebody already had that. I was a ham in Florida, and he wasn't producing a program, and so I reached him, and he said, I'm letting it go. You can have it. So I got Ham Radio. Didn't even have to pay him for it. HamRadioNow.com. I bought some high-definition cameras. I bought a new editing system. I went to the Orlando Hamcation in 2012 and shot a series of interviews and a tour, and I made them all episode one and episode two. So I started the problem that I have where I'm at episode 332, but I've really made about 400 shows. You can't tell because the episode numbers, some of them have 5-6 shows within them. So that was a bad idea. Ham Nation did give me a farewell send off after I had produced the first Orlando shows. They let me back on as a guest one more time and I got to talk about it and then goodbye. So I owe them that. That was nice of them to do. I realized I couldn't keep up making the shows at the rate that I've been making them and do field production for all of them. Field production takes too much time. So I bought one of these little webcams and I added Wirecast, which is a video studio in a box. It's the thing that I push the buttons on here that lets me switch the cameras. This is the studio that I'm in right now. This is what it looks like. And this is the computer that's got the Wirecast, and I'm seeing you guys on this big monitor, and there's another monitor over there that I'm seeing my switched output on. So I started with a little webcam and an early version of Wirecast and Skype, and I did some studio interviews. I didn't do them here. I didn't have this thing put together yet. I did them over at my editing bay. And if you look at some of the first dozen or so shows that aren't field shows, you'll see those relatively crude interview shows from the studio. And then I spent a lot more money on cameras. I'm now on my third generation of cameras, my second generation of high-def cameras. The first generation, I'll use tape. the DV tape or the HDV version of DV tape. I am now on tapeless. I bought a bunch of microphones for field production and these about three of these HAL mics. So Bob, you have supported you a lot with three PR40 HAL mics. I bought lights and made a pretty serious field or studio production out of it. Has ended up as this studio. And yes, I do have a ham shack. It's that's back there. That's my ham shack, which is the background for my studio. I don't really get on the air very much here. And I now promise and vow to you, the members of SNARS, the hams watching on Facebook and this program, that I will never do another field production piece again.
Never?
Yeah, I know. I told you that, didn't I, David?
Yeah.
Yeah. And, yeah, I will.
I've heard it before.
Yeah.
But I know you rolled tape at field day, right?
I did. And and that's why I'm telling you I'm never going to do this again, because I'm in the middle of editing all that. And it is driving me crazy.
That's okay. I'll become the field correspondent. I'll start working on that.
Cool. Yeah, if I get somebody else to do this, that'd be fine. So I hate editing. All of my career has been editing. I like doing this. I like sitting in front of the camera and microphone and punditizing. So today's ham radio media landscape. Well, when I was getting started, there wasn't very much. And I was complaining about how little anyone was shooting even still pictures of hams doing ham stuff and no video. And now there's lots of shows out there. As I was getting ready for doing this program, I started to make a list, and I've only got a very partial list. Ham Nation, you know, still the big dog. Amateur Logic, arguably the first television program. Newsline has been around for a lot longer than anybody else, and they started by shipping cassettes to people to play over their repeaters and a phone line thing. And now there's a podcast. ICQ, the ICQ podcast, been around for a long time. TX Factor has become a very well-produced but only occasionally presented program out of the UK. QSO Today is an interview show out of Israel. Ham Radio 360 used to be called Faux Time. Now, let's talk about bad names. They pivoted to Ham Radio 360. Ham Radio 2.0, the Phasing Line podcast, Ham Talk Live, everything ham radio. That is as far as I could go in my list to before it was time to push the button and start doing this talk with you guys. But there's a bunch more. I have started a forum on Reddit, something on Reddit called Hamcasters. And I'm trying to gather everybody over there to announce their shows on Reddit. Only a few are doing that right now. But there's a bunch more. So one more thing. Where's the ARRL in all of this? They are behind the curve. They do some YouTube videos. They do some little mini product reviews and occasional other stuff. And their media guy, Sean Kutzko, KX9X, is starting to do some more interviews and things at Hamfests. And they stick them on YouTube. But they're not doing them as a show. You got to find them. They are doing audio versions of their newsletter and the e-newsletter. And they have finally released their first real audio podcast called The Doctor Is In. It's with the columnist that does the doctor column and the QST editor. And that's a real podcast. They sit down and they record it, and it's really good. If you haven't listened to that, you should. It really is really good. They don't have a TV studio yet. Budgets are tight at ARRL. You know, they're not awash with cash. So, but it apparently is not something that they have considered to be a high priority. I, here by myself, and now with David, have a TV studio. I could afford to do it. Interesting story a little bit behind that. I'll deviate just a minute. You see the guy behind me? That's the Travelocity roaming gnome. The reason he's there is that about the time I was getting things started around 2007, I was freelancing at an ad agency, and they had gotten the Travelocity account. They'd had it for a year or so, and they'd produced a bunch of TV commercials for Travelocity. But they were going to pivot the account. They were starting to do this roaming gnome thing, and they wanted an announcer to work with them, and it was going to be a kind of a give and take thing. And I was the audio engineer. I was sitting there doing a recording session as they were auditioning announcers for being the other guy, not the roaming gnome. The roaming gnome is a British comedian. His name is Harry Enfield. And they had him. They've had him for a while. But they were looking for just an announcer. And they had gone through five or six people, and they weren't getting what they wanted. And I could tell what they wanted because I'm old. And everybody else was young, and they couldn't quite get it. They didn't ask in these terms, but what they were looking for was a combination or a cross between Ted Baxter from the old Mary Tyler Moore show. You know, Ted Baxter, he started in 1960, you know, small AM radio station, and even older, the very super stilted announcer in Movie Tone News. Okay, how many out there had ever encountered Movie Tone News? Yeah, you guys are old. Okay. All right. So that's what I got they wanted. They didn't know it because they'd never heard of either one, but that's what I was getting. So I got on the mic. They asked me if I'd be willing to do it. I've done a little recording for them before, nothing they'd ever used on the air, but just fill in tracks. They said, "Would you be willing to do this?" And I said, "Well, twist my arm." So they gave me the copy, and I went into the booth, and I said, "Travelocity presents the Roaming Gnome, denouncer of travel myths." And they said, "That's it." And 7 television commercials and about 50 radio commercials and approximately $200,000 in SAG union rates later, here we are. And
you guys got a low battery warning. We may have lost them.
We may have lost them.
Did we lose you?
Well, we may.
No, we're still here. My battery died on the camera, so I'll put a new one in.
Okay, so it's just their video. Their Skype is still going. Cool. Right. So, it also bought the Q-mobile. If you've watched any of the episodes, and if you're curious about the Q-mobile, go see Ham Radio Now episode 300. That's got the Q-mobile in it. And so here we are. Oh, by the way, ARRL, you've got the perfect name that you haven't used yet. QSTV. QSTV. I give that to you as a, I would really like to see them compete with me and do a good show. For a while, I kind of thought it would be nice if they hired me to do their show, but I realized that I don't want to do their show. I don't want to do what they would want me to do. I want to do what I want to do. So we've got this new media landscape, and am I satisfied? You know, I was pretty unhappy with the way things got started. Am I satisfied now? Plead the fifth. Not going to say it. David, are you satisfied?
Well, I'm enjoying it. So you missed a little bit here and there, Gary. So I know you've been doing the show. You've had some other co-hosts along the way.
Yeah, a little bit.
Jeff was around. How many episodes do you think Jeff did?
He's probably been in 10 or 20.
And then a little more than a year ago, I know you were looking to branch out into more, do some more MCOM shows. And so you put out a call at the very end of the episode. There's always a little teaser trailer kind of thing to keep folks till the end. And I happened to be on vacation. I saw it. And before the episode was totally over, I had sent you an email and it took a little while to get back. And so I've been doing the show for, I don't know, about 6 months now, maybe a little bit more.
Yeah. And we started with you as the MCOM extra guy because you're absolutely. An EC in Los Angeles, an emergency coordinator.
And from an amateur radio perspective, that's really mostly my interest. And so far I'm enjoying it. I'm happy with it. I know, we'd love to have more views and, to drive a little bit more show stuff. I know you don't want to be out in the field as much. but so far so good. I'm having a good time. Yeah. I'll tell all the folks out there, my studio is not quite as elaborate as Gary's.
Yeah. Give it time. You've already made improvements, big improvements.
Well, and I'll tell you, I did a whole bunch of stuff yesterday. I got another PC, and I'm working on the open broadcast system. So pretty soon they'll be a little bit more exciting.
Created a monster, and I'll tell you why. I was happy with David, and we promoted him from MCOM Extra co-host to regular co-host. First of all, it's nice to be able to talk to somebody. I can monologue, as you can tell. I can monologue, but it's nice to be able to talk to somebody. But when I first hooked up with you on Skype and we did the first shows, what I discovered was your personality meshes really well. The guys on Newsline, they tried to be a little bit too professional broadcastery. And a lot of the other ham radio shows, a lot of the other hosts, the folks that have had the courage, the audacity, the chutzpah, the ego, because it takes a lot of ego, to go do a show, they don't have the personality and they don't have the chops, whatever it takes to be not broadcastery professional. And I may even be more broadcastery professional in doing this talk to you guys now than I like to be. But David, you're just calm. You're not trying to put on anything, or if you are, it doesn't show. And you fit in. So
thanks.
It's great.
Every once in a while, I think I should be doing the broadcaster voice, but it never comes right. Right. Yeah,
and it wouldn't work.
Yeah.
So that's the show that we do, and a lot of you guys have seen it. I hope you like it, and I think we probably used up as much or more time than was allocated. Oops, for this part of the presentation. But if you got any questions, we'd be happy to answer them.
All right, thank you. Any questions you guys have?
A few more shows on digital, please.
Yeah. So that's my question to you guys is, what do you want to see more of? So I got digital. I know I'm working on some digital and some DMR. What else are people out there interested in seeing? Anything? Bueller?
This is the hard part. It takes a while. They'll warm up in just a second.
I saw lips moving, but I didn't hear. What was that?
Yeah, question. Go ahead.
Are you able to podcast remotely, like from rather than from your homes or something? When you talk about going out on the field and doing documentaries, are you able to actually like, so if it's like just for example, Dayton or something like that, go to Dayton and do like a live podcast at this point? You know, obviously we weren't thinking we'd be at this point, you know, several years ago, and now we can actually do that.
Yeah, live. The problem with live from remote locations is just the internet connection. The Dayton folks, the Hamvention folks, had internet available for $100 or so, and I didn't want to spring for $100 for the internet that they had. Plus, at this point, I would have to take this equipment. And, well, this equipment is designed to go in the field. It's in a box. It's got a handle. And I have taken it to Tapper conferences and even to Hamfests. It's a little too fragile. So I may build a field package to do something like that, because you've seen the shows that I've done from there, but I record them all and I edit them, switch cameras later and put them on. So, yeah, I would like to, sort of like a maybe. Tom Medlin, W5KUB, does his shows live from there. But getting that internet connection, that's the critical part. You want to look good. And it's not cheap. So see Arvin. Not cheap equals see Arvin. HamRadioNow.tv. And by the way, David's interested in what you guys like to see. I don't care. I don't care what you want to see. I'm doing the shows I want to do.
but I'll make sure we sneak some of the ones in that you want to see now and then.
When David makes a suggestion, we do his show. Especially if he does the legwork.
Yeah. If I can get a guest or I can get somebody who's specializes in one of the area we want to cover, it makes it a lot easier.
Also, commercial radios and amateur radio would be cool to see.
Commercial radios and what?
Commercial radios used for amateur radio. Like the text line.
So some of that, like the conversion stuff?
Yeah.
Okay.
And also, have you guys thought about having other hams that have broadcast experience, such as myself, with 12 and a half years and 15 years, going out there and adding on to your show, too, to have other live locations that have been manifest?
We have collaborated with a few other people, the Phasing Line guys and Ham Radio 2.0.
Ham Radio 2.0, yeah.
But not to bring in live stuff from remote locations. That's a possibility. And here's my contribution to commercial equipment and amateur. And I'm sorry that the little nameplate fell off, but this is an HT220. It was my pride and joy back in about 1976.
Nice.
So Yeah, I've got a couple of Johnsons back there. I'm not a big fan of commercial radio used in ham radio because it's not flexible enough. You got to program it by computer. If you're out in the field, you can't change it unless you got a laptop in your car like I do. So although it's robust and the receivers are more intermod resistant and stuff, you can't really play ham radio with them. Yeah.
Propagation and DXing things such as troposphere ducking, moon bounce, minimums you can do on that, maybe even demonstration.
Yeah, I've actually done a show on all of those things at one point or another, and the main thing I'm trying not to do is training programs, tutorials, classroom stuff, other than the forums that I do. They're classroom stuff. But somebody else has done all that legwork. I just point the camera at them. And it's not that those things aren't valuable. It's not that those things wouldn't be popular and that you wouldn't get something really good out of them. And other people are doing some things like that. It's just things I don't want to do. They're a lot of work. And what is easy? This is easy. This is sitting here talking. This is easy. And that's all I'm really willing to do anymore. Other than I'll still cover the Tapper forums. And I only did one forum. I did the Tapper forum at Dayton. But Jason from Ham Radio 2.0, KC5HWB, he picked up the slack and recorded a bunch of other forums at Dayton. So, but the smoke and solder stuff, I'm not going to do that. I've done just a very few programs on building things or technology. Jeff and I built a dipole. Now, it was very popular, you know, the view count's way up there, but I guess what I'm saying is I'll suffer along with getting 2,000-4,000 views on a program that is easier to do than, a personality program than a training program that might get 50,000 views. I did.
Yeah,
go ahead.
Gary in our niche is really like, you know, pick a topic and kind of peel layers of the onion off and really get deep into it and figure out, you know, the good, the bad, and the ugly, and really, really talk about it and talk through it all.
Yeah.
Much more than solder this here, solder that there, so on and so forth.
Now, I do have a plan, and I better get to it before this radio becomes totally obsolete. This is the TYT MD380. It's the DMR radio of choice these days, although it's going to be eclipsed pretty soon by other radios. And I'm going to do a program on how I learned about DMR and programming this radio and the CS800 I've got in my car, and take you through, in the process of taking you through the programming of the radio, I'm going to talk about the things that I've learned about how DMR works. And I'm not an expert, but I'm more of an expert than most people are. And after I do that show, then I'm going to try to get some real DMR experts on to tell me how full of crap I was.
And I got a guy for that, I think.
Okay. And I'm going to try to get that done in the next month or so, because other radios are coming out. What I expect to happen with DMR, excuse me, is that radios that are designed for hams that have, say, a VFO, not a capacitor VFO, synthesizer VFO. You know what I mean by a handy talkie with a VFO. Things you can push buttons on the panel and make the radio do things. They're just starting to come out. I expect, because DMR is becoming a hit, I expect ham radio DMR radios to actually happen. I don't know if they'll happen from ICOM, Yaesu, or Kenwood, or even Elinco. Maybe Elinco, because they don't have a dog in the fight with another mode yet. But it would be nice if ICOM, Yaesu, and Kenwood would say, yeah, DMR seems to be quite the thing. Let's sell some radios that are made for hams that do a good job of DMR. There's that company called DV4. They've got some dongles and stuff out now, and we're waiting for their mobile to arrive, and it will do all of the digital modes. It'll be expensive, $1,200. And they're still trying to get it off the production line. But it'll be a hamish radio. Won't be one of these things like this. You know, this radio's got 16 channels and then multiple zones, but within a zone, zone is like a memory bank and you're stuck with 16 channels. That's too limited. It's too hard to use this radio unless you're just willing to use it very in a very limited way right around home. I get on the road, it drives me nuts. Anything else?
Have you been back to W3AO?
Okay, now this is a sad story. At the 10th anniversary, the 10th anniversary of the last big field day. The last big field day was 2004. And the reason I called it the last big field day is after that, they never did 50 more stations, 50 type stations. They got down into the 20s, maybe the low 30s. And they'd done that before. And the reason that happened was the ARL changed the rules. When they did 50 stations, they could get the 100 bonus points for every station. And that 50 stations, that adds up. It didn't matter. They would have won. You know, okay, field day is not a contest. They would have won anyway. Head and shoulders above everybody else in the field day rankings. Okay, it is a contest. For years, and they still are, but the ARL changed the rules so that after 20 stations, no more bonus points. So they kind of lost their incentive to do that. So the 10th anniversary, 2014, I went back up there. I went with Jeff, and we recorded what they were doing for 2014. And the title will be the next big field day. They were only, you know, 2021A or something like that. I haven't edited it yet. Now it's only 3 years.
Only 3 years.
It's not 7 years yet. I was hoping to edit it before this year's field day, maybe before next year's field day. But yeah, it's kind of an evergreen program. But yeah, I went back up there, and I am never going to do another field production piece again. Yeah. Never.
I don't believe you.
Crossing my fingers.
All right. Well, thanks, guys. We're probably short on our time over here, but thank you guys for doing this. This is great.
All right. Well, thanks for inviting us.
Yeah, I appreciate the invitation. And you guys had breakfast, right?
Yes.
They didn't make you wait for me.
$12, you can have breakfast.
All right. Bye-bye. Oh, you know how we finish this program? I don't know if these guys know it or not. I'm going to give you guys the chance to say it. There's a really bad Hollywood phrase in ham radio that is used to that we close the programs with, and hams always complain because they say it's bad operating procedure. We say over and out over and out. What I want you guys is to all in unison say over and out in 3, 2, 1.
Over and out.
Awesome.
Bye, guys.
7-3.
All right, 7-3.
That was cool.
Yeah, so we're still on Facebook here. We got them to say it.
You know, really sure we're on Facebook still.
In theory, my green light is still on.
Is it still on? Okay. It looked like at some point it stopped.
I've never even looked to see if we made it to Facebook in the first place because things kind of went in a hurry.
Yeah, it started and I said hi to the room. I'm not sure how long the video is. Oh, maybe we're still there. Oh yeah, we're still there. Okay,
so still on Facebook.
At some point on my other screen, it looked like it had stopped and it wasn't going anywhere.
All this technology.
Yeah. All right. Sorry. In the beginning, I wasn't exactly sure how this show was going to go. So I just kind of sat back and let you ride.
Do you ever know how a show is going to go?
Okay. Good point.
Well, because do I ever know how a show is going to go?
Yeah, that makes sense. That makes sense. I thought it went well. I thought it was interesting.
I had a good time. I didn't notice anybody falling asleep.
No. And actually most everybody, I was worried at some point I could see the room. And so, you know, I know at some point, In our Saturday morning meetings, because we meet at this time, we have a bye this month because we have a big drill next weekend. I know when some of the speakers come for the 8:30 portion, when it gets slow and dull, everybody gets up to go to the bathroom or some of the guys go outside and smoke or whatever. So that was a good measure. And I didn't see too much of that going on.
Too much of it. I wasn't watching the room very well. So
Yeah, I was keeping an eye. Most everybody was there in their seat. That was good.
I usually don't do this. I mean, I don't do pages of notes, but I wanted to stay on track and keep on moving. And what I didn't have time to do was time it to go through and see how long it was going to be. And it was 45 minutes.
That was pretty good. Q&A. I threw my bio in while we were getting started, and I'll work on that a little bit more. I know I have more to say, but I didn't want to go on too long considering we already went 45 minutes.
Well, we'll see if anybody else ever invites us to do this again, but they don't have to because they can just play this one back.
There you go. Well, I was thinking maybe at one of our meetings, I'll invite you, and because I can take my extensive technical studio setup and bring it there, and they have internet. I'll have to check to see how good the internet connection is. Maybe next month I'll Skype you from the meeting and see, because they have Wi-Fi there. I don't know how good it'll be, or I could try from my my hotspot on my phone.
Okay,
see what it looks like.
Yeah, when would that be?
They meet the first Saturday, same time, same place, same time as we're at. First
okay.
Saturday.
Yeah.
So you won't be around next month, but maybe the following or whatever it is.
I will be around early in August. This disappearing act that I was talking about will begin, starting the weekend of the eclipse.
Okay. Got it.
I will be
eclipsed. That'll be like the 21st. That's still like 6 or 8 weeks away.
Yeah.
The
moon will get in front of the show, and I will disappear. But unlike the sun, which will reappear in another few minutes, I will be gone for weeks.
Actually, that's good. So that means I got like 6 weeks or so to get the OBS going.
Yeah. I'll give you the keys to the kingdom and see what you do. I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah. So I got a PC, I ordered some extra RAM. I got to download the software when the RAM comes for that. And, I think I have to get a video card. It's kind of hard to tell exactly what the minimum requirements are. I did a couple searches on their site, and some places look like you needed to have a special graphics card, but then some people said that's if you're gaming, and I'll figure it out.
A good graphics card is probably a good idea.
Yeah. That's what I think.
This computer has, NVIDIA 670, I think is the number, which was not the highest end they had, but a fairly high-end one at the time. Mm-hmm. And I just bought a new video card for the editing computer because the card that's in it, an NVIDIA, I think the number is 480. It's now pretty old. And in fact, Premiere Pro doesn't support it anymore. And so I've been getting lots of freezes and crashes and stuff that I believe are video card related.
Got it. So I have a ton of questions, and I'll start writing them down. But if I do OBS, it's going to all go out live like this. And then for posting it to YouTube, I got to like take it into like iMovie or something and put in the lower thirds and all the graphics and stuff like that. That's what you do after the fact. You don't probably use iMovie, but you use some other tool to do that.
I use Premiere Pro. And you could get away with Premiere Elements easily, which is a $100 program.
Yep.
And
then you could share the you got all the graphics and already packaged and stuff.
But as you begin with OBS, I would look at doing your own title scheme.
Okay.
Don't worry about copying my title scheme, because it's probably going to change, because there's a titler in Wirecast that I just have never taken the time to learn. Mm-hmm. But if I were using the titler in Wirecast, when we finish recording a show,
it'd be done.
We'd be done.
right.
Trim up the beginning and the end. And, you know, I still have to render it out, because this is, we will have recorded for about an hour, and the file that will come out of this will be about 15 gigabytes. Well, maybe not quite, maybe 9 gigabytes. And I can't put a 9 gigabyte file onto YouTube. It would take a week. So I'd render it down to something that's under 1 gigabyte and then send that up. At the moment, I've got myself stuck with putting the titles in afterwards, but I don't like how much time that takes.
All right. Well, one of my friends, one of my Boy Scout friends, Steve, just texted me saying, "Oh, you've got a friend in the business. He'll help me out."
He must be watching.
He is.
Hi, Steve.
Yeah, he does. Cool. He does hardcore editing for lots of fun stuff.
But you're in Los Angeles.
Yes, we are.
Which, you know, that's, I didn't mention it, but there are a lot of hams in media. And a lot of them in LA, but a lot of them all over the country, all over the world.
Yeah.
Mostly in the technical side of things, only a few of them in the, talent is what we call it. Or, in, you know, somewhere in between the producer ranks, things like that, you know, guys like John Amadeo, who was producing Last Man Standing. There's hams seated throughout it, and that may have been my biggest frustration, is we had the talent, the on-camera talent and the behind-the-camera talent, and we had available technology even before it got pretty inexpensive, and we didn't use it. We had Bill Pasternak and W6AQ. I've had him on the show. Got my call sign. They produced a few sort of intro to ham radio shows over the course of decades, on starting on film, and nobody else. Where have they been? So that's why I'm here. You know, why me? Why?
I'd bet some of them think they're too busy, but
I'm sure
I'm glad you're doing it. Glad we're doing it.
And I was at the beginning, you know, Bob, don't ask me to do this every week, because now I'm doing the average of 2 to 3 shows a week.
Yeah, I know. And when you started, you thought maybe we'll do one a month.
Yeah. Well, one MCOM extra a month.
Yeah.
That shows you how much actual planning goes into anything I do. Not much.
That's right.
These things begin as fever dreams in the middle of the night when I can't sleep. Mm-hmm. And you know, that happens for a while, and then it's like, okay, I'm going to do something about this.
Insomnia is a good thing sometimes.
Yeah.
We gotta try pull Marty in from camp at some point.
I get the impression that there's no technology at this camp.
Well, he's online.
Oh, he is.
I don't know. Okay.
Because he said you're not going to hear from online. Me.
Yeah, he says he shows online. But who knows? Maybe he's just taking a ham radio hiatus.
I don't know. He just said he'd be gone. So I kind of expected him. And it may just be because they got him real busy.
Yeah, with, maybe.
You know, swimming and archery and tennis.
It's all the stuff I'd do if I went to camp.
Yeah.
Which I'm missing out on again this year.
I have no idea what they do at camp anymore.
Oh, I do.
Okay, fun. Yeah. Okay. So it's still swimming and archery and tennis and horseback riding.
We don't do tennis, but yeah. Well, you know, ours is Boy Scout camp. I think he's doing one of the, like, the Jewish youth camps. It's a little different. Probably less rifle and merit badge and more fun stuff. It's all good.
Oi.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I think we're done. I think.
Very good.
I'll
keep working on the OBS, and when I get it up and running, maybe we'll just do a couple of test sessions where you send me and I recorded here.
Yeah, that would be cool.
Yeah,
I'll be impressed. And don't, and you want to do it as well as you can, but don't try to do what I'm doing here based on years of experience. Do the best, you know, available to what you're going to do, and it'll get better.
Yep.
And sink the ship.
Yeah, there you go. I'm not sinking the ship. We're going to grow it.
Yeah, because you'll start doing the things people want to see.
Well, we'll see.
until you discover how much work they are.
Yeah. Yeah, right. I don't think we're gonna do smoke and solder. But you never know. I do have I did buy the new Heathkit world's most accurate clock. But I don't expect to do a show out of it.
You might be able to get one of those latent wannabe producers to do their smoke and solder for you. I mean, that's what they did on Ham Nation. And first they got George and wore him out. Randy. And then they got Randy and wore him out.
Yeah.
So between the two of them, I mean, they come up with some, but they're, you know, not every week anymore.
Yep. So you like could, you said, it's a lot to produce.
George will tell a story of going to a transmitter and fighting snakes and stuff.
All right, Gary, so, you have a great weekend.
And Bob evidently is building things on pine boards or something.
Yeah, so. he's trying to kill off some of the older hams, I think.
Yeah, I haven't noticed him railing about us wannabe podcasters yet, or recently, though.
I bet somebody talked to him about it.
Could be.
I bet.
You know what I keep forgetting to do at the beginning of the show?
Mm-hmm.
Is that
we're the most important.
Yeah, this is Ham Radio Now, the world's most important amateur radio program on the internet. I keep forgetting to say that. Don't let me get away with not saying that anymore.
Okay, you got it. I'll work on that.
Throwing a lot of responsibility David's way.
That's okay. I'm going to start putting post-it notes up on the screen like I do at work. Remember this, remember that, remember the other thing.
I've tried really hard not to cover my screen with post-it notes, and I'm succeeding over here on this side of the studio. Are there any sitting on the... No post-it notes on the editing side either, so... I like this picture. I've promoted you to large economy size, and I'm still
woo-hoo
here in the little box.
Yeah, because then nobody can see your mess, and they can see all of mine.
That's your studio.
Yes, it is. Well, it's my junkyard.
I've turned that camera a little bit because I wanted people to be able to see what I had going here. But normally, it shows the table back behind me, which is
I like this angle because it kind of shows what's going on.
Yeah. Should turn over to that camera once in a while and just talk this way. Now I can't see anything that's happening over here, so I have no idea how to run the show.
It just means you need one more little monitor on the end of that wooden desk that you're looking towards. So you got a kind of a view of it.
I could do that. What I need is a technical director. So I can just sit and talk and someone else can punch the buttons. My technical director moved to L.A.,
Oh, well, you could hire Cindy.
Once you get, Cindy's got no interest. Once you get OBS working, maybe we'll send Cliff over and he can be your technical director because he's out there.
There you go. Yeah. I'm going to have to get a part-time job to support all that. Or maybe I'll get one of my Steves that are very in the technical area to help bring me some equipment and run some of that stuff.
Yeah. Well, you'll discover that this is a lot more fun than real work. Unfortunately, you're not on the cusp of being able to retire.
Yeah, well, we keep doing it anyway.
So that's the one saving grace for me is I got old enough to retire and start collecting the Social Security and not have to go do freelance anymore.
Yeah.
But, well, the freelance clients kind of let me know that wasn't going to happen anyway. they stopped calling. Except in dire emergencies. So I finally told them both, my Pro Tools skills are getting rusty. My interest is getting low. So I found a new freelancer for the ad agency and it took a while, but I kind of turned things over. And then the other studio, they said, our guy is going on vacation. Our main guy, are you available? And I said, yeah, but here's the deal. I'm kind of rusty, and I don't think it's going to work out very well. And that's it. They just didn't call. I mean, they're friends. I like them and all that, but they realized that this old horse was getting a little too old.
That's all right. You got this, and you'll start up the other ones that you're... Have you started working on that other podcast you're working on?
Not really, but I want to. It's not a secret. It's... Well, I was going to do a show, and I still may, that is animal-oriented, because everyone's seen the cats and stuff. But lately, my interest, I'm not usually this fickle about things, but lately my interest has been in doing a political talk show.
Yep, we talked about that.
Yeah, well, we're still on Facebook, and we're still recording, so now the audience gets to learn.
Yep.
And it will be local, not nationwide. I mean, it's on the internet, you know, anybody can watch around the world, but it'll be aimed at local. And, you know, I suppose I could reveal, I don't think there's any secret about my political leanings. You know, I'm a little bit left and most hams are a little bit right. A little bit.
Yeah. I don't agree with you more than a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah. At least what you hear.
Yeah.
The, You know, the Rush Limbaughs and Fox Newses have loosened the tongues of hams who used to be follow that stricture of no politics on the radio. Mm-hmm. And so you hear from them. It's not overwhelming, but it, you know, it's here and there. You'll hear from them, and they will, you know, they'll be one-upping each other with how radical they can be, how extreme they can be in their right-wing proclamations. And it's all the snark, you know, no one's having a conversation. It's all, you know, the snark band.
No, I mean, it's interesting because at our Aries meetings, there's actually kind of polarized on both sides. And,
the left wing hams are not talking.
We're a little quieter until someone goes on the attack. And then there's a couple of them that'll speak up and, you know, call a spade or whatever, or let everyone else know that we all don't agree and let's move back to ham radio or something else.
Yeah. And I've done that a time or two now too. I'll let them go for a while and I'll break in and say, I didn't get on this repeater or network or whatever to hear a warmed over rehash of Rush Limbaugh. But if you guys want to get into it, let's get into it. And it stops, just stops.
Yeah.
Cause they're not interested in anything, but echoing the snark.
Yeah.
So, and I don't feel like bringing that into ham radio, but I do very much feel like bringing it into a show. I'm not the most astute political person. I follow the news, but I don't obsess over it. Mm-hmm. And I try to listen to a variety of media, although I can't watch Fox News for very long.
I try not to watch any of the news anymore. Yeah.
I try to absorb a fair amount of it.
Yeah.
It's also very, you're not really getting much of a story. You know,
right.
The anyone who tries to get into policy details and things like that, well, that turns into broccoli broadcasting really fast and everyone zones out. Everyone really would rather hear the snark and not the policy, but the procedures. I'm losing my terminology. During the elections, they want to hear the horse race. They don't want to hear the policy discussions during an election are kind of useless anyway, because it's all talking points of the day and no details. The details just get really boring. So what I'm looking to try to do is to kind of walk that line and stay away from the snark and get into a little more of the detail of what we're really talking about, but without getting so deep into it that it's, you know, just, a college lecture. I'm not capable of that anyway. I'm not that smart.
Well, hopefully that'll work out.
And it's got to be personality. You know, I think I've got a personality.
Yep.
Maybe.
And some of what'll drive that too is who are the people that you bring in to converse with.
Yeah.
You bring the right people in, it'll work out. You bring the wrong people in, it won't. And, you know, you'll have good shows and you'll have not good shows.
Yep. And I don't know that I'll ever actually do that, but that's what I'm thinking about. And so if you're really successful with this, I'll be a guest on Ham Radio now and then.
Okay. I'll
go off and do other stuff. He's buying it. He's buying it.
Yeah. I'm having a good time.
Well, good.
It's about the right amount for me now that I can sneak out to the garage and so far everybody in the house is all good with it. And every once in a while, like we bring a guest star from inside the house in the show.
Yeah. And this is the first one we've done in your morning, I think.
Yeah. And I think we did one or two other ones.
Yeah. And you're a morning
guy.
Weekends
are good for that.
Yeah. You're a morning guy.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I skipped my early walk today, but that's cause I had to pick the boy up and didn't get home until after 11.
All right. I'm heading over to Jeff's. We are going to try to fix a problem with my ICOM 7000.
Cool.
Hopefully not destroy it. And then I'll finish producing this program and getting it online later on tonight.
Super. All right. We'll talk soon.
Okay.
7-3.
Goodbye to Facebook.
Bye, Facebook.
And the recording system.